Hey, good morning, everybody. Thank you for being here on time after this long evening yesterday. I really enjoyed very much the poster session. So my name is Isabelle Le Dourac. I am a professor at École Normale Supérieure de Cachan. This is a high education institution in the south of Paris, quite close to Paris. And I am leading a physics laboratory devoted to molecular photonics, that is the interaction between light and molecules. So today, and you will hear a lot about molecules, so don't be afraid about some sometimes relatively more complex formulae. And then I will speak about the way to optimize the quadratic nonlinear response of molecular materials mainly, but I also include some inorganic ones. And at the first level this morning, I will speak about optimization at the microscopic level, at the level of chemical bonds and molecules. Okay, so the dream of material scientists wanting to optimize a material, whatever the application could be, is to find the way to predict and to design some new structure and molecules. And in our domain, this is this relatively poetic picture, which was designed more than 30 years ago in my previous lab in the Telecommunication Research Center. And this was a dream of scientists trying to catch new molecules. And of course, in our case, it's not purely random hunting, but it will be some rationalization of the way to find and to fabricate the most efficient structure for quadratic nonlinear optics. So to start, there is a relatively standard molecule. It is a dye, an organic dye. It's red, as indicated here, this pale red one. And how to come from this kind of structure, but we will start from much simpler systems, and to obtain really operational devices. In this case, this is an electro-optic modulator, which has been proposed by Pacific Wave, an American company, but it was difficult to lead to result in a wide commercial production because of the difficulty to modify the fabrication tools and factories in this big industry. And so polymers will have probably a future, but maybe it will take some time for industrial maturation. Okay, so this is the outline. So we start with a general consideration about the definition of microscopic nonlinearities, so-called hyperpolarizabilities, and have a quick look about optical frequency dependence resulting on time-dependent perturbation theory, and the problem of symmetries, which is important in quadratic phenomena. Then we will describe the exploration of hyperpolarizability of one-dimensional dipolar structure in inorganics and organic molecules, and shows a few examples of organic molecules and optimizations. And then, beyond one-dimensional scheme, we will explore two- and three-dimensional multipolar structure and use some elements of tensorial analysis to develop a new strategy for high-dimensionality systems and see how, for both inorganic and organic systems, it's possible to obtain a three-dimensional nonlinear response. Okay, so linear and nonlinear microscopic polarization. So it's only a page for notation and definitions. So we use, in general, Cartesian notations. And permanent polarization, I remind you, this is dipole moment independent on electric and external fields. The first order polarization is so-called the first polarizability, which relates on a linear manner the induced dipole induced by an electric field and the electric field itself. This alpha is a vector, this is a two-rank tensor, which can be described as a matrix. Second-order polarization relates induced second-order polarization to the incident electric field, which are expressed as the square of electric field, through a third-rank tensor, beta YGK. And this are Cartesian indices. So you can see that this beta, as the chi2, can have a maximum 27 independent components. But in our case, in a transparent regime and in a relatively symmetric system, this number of components will strongly reduce. Third order polarization is only for your information. Then in this corresponds to the case where the induced polarization is proportional to the third power of electric field with a four-rank tensor gamma. So the total induced polarization is expressed in the form of the sum of all these terms, and the nonlinear response starts here. So here, the notation indicates that alpha, beta, gamma are tensors with the rank tensor, and this is a tensorial product of the electric field applied to the molecule. And this tensorial product, you recognize the so-called field tensors. I guess that Benoît Boulanger has spoken a lot about this during the first week. So this is, in fact, a tensorial product of two tensors resulting in vector contribution. So there are various kind of definitions. So this is a conventional definition of this dipole moment. And these are different possibility of units. So this is an international unit system. But a lot of people, including myself, still use some old system. This is an American system with centimeter gram seconds, which are the fundamental units. Okay, then the next point will be related to symmetry. And what does it mean? That a high second order hyperpolarizability will require first a large number of electrons, and electrons must be sensitive to the action of electric field. It means that it should display a high electronic polarizability, meaning that the electrons are not too tightly attached to nuclei. It means also, because it is a quadratic effect, it means non-central symmetry. So you have heard probably before. And here, in the following, we will start with the most commonly used systems, which are one-dimensional and dipolar. So dipolar systems are non-centrosymmetric, and they can be also oriented under external electric fields. So we shall see this afternoon. But it's raised a question. So you must have polarizability, we must have non-central symmetry. So what happens, for example, if we imagine to have strongly ionic bonds, such as halogenides? In this case, you know that there is a very small low electronic density between atoms, and the polarizability of the so-called ionic bond is very low. So we feel that we will have to find a trade-off, a compromise between a good electronic polarizability and the so-called ionicity or ionicity of the chemical bond. And that will be relatively permanent issue of this research about optimization of dipolar system. So hyperpolarizability, we can develop a general expression which is relatively complex, but this contains some so-called resonant term which corresponds to the difference between the fundamental frequency of the incident light or its harmonic with respect to the energy of the transitions involved in the expression of this hyperpolarizability. It also implies transition moments between different levels. And for one-dimensional system, we will limit ourselves to the terms parallel to the molecular axis. We can choose it at y. This means that beta will be considered as beta of vector and with strong anisotropy, strong difference between the different terms, one term, the diagonal one being dominant. So this expression, we shall see that it will become much simpler when adding some symmetry elements. So let's come now to the hyperpolarizability of dipoles and start not with organic molecules, which can be seen impressive, but starting with a simple model, early model in organic. So there are plenty of other models to describe the nonlinear response of inorganics, especially semiconductors. But this early model will show really the importance of the trade-off between polarizability and dissymmetry of the bond. So this is assuming, this study assumes, which is of course a strong and a rough approximation, that we are dealing with a single covalent bond, and this covalent bond is governed by the electronegativity of its elements. So we assume that this bond is made of two different atoms, A and B, with the atomic number ZA, ZB, and separated by this distance R. So the simplified description of this chemical bond is related to the molecular orbital theory between A and B. And because their electronegativity are different, these two levels have different values. And we can make some bonding and antibonding molecular orbitals. The energy separating these orbitals being Eg. And we have a term describing the dissymmetry of the molecules. This is the C factor. And in the model, Phillips and von Vechten express this total energy of this diatomic system as a term of two origins, the so-called homopolar energy, which corresponds to a fictional symmetric molecules, so it's corresponding to the covalent character of the chemical bond, and another term, which is named heteropolar, which corresponds to the energy difference between the energy levels of atomic orbitals, and this related to ionicity and dissymmetry of the bond. So, and we can express also this energy as related to the interaction energy between the two atoms, related also to the overlap of their orbitals. So this energy, total energy, can be accessed via the dielectric constant of the compound using this expression that ionicity of the diatomic bonds is defined as the ratio between the square of this heteropolar divided by the total energy. And then we infer the linear polarizability as a function of this energy gap. So how to come to hyperpolarizability? This is the so-called bond charge model. The polarization induced by an external electric field is expressed as a linear term alpha E, and it's also the product of the charge and the displacement, the change of the length of the diatomic bond. So this modification of the bond length will change the energy of chi1, and we can make a development of this chi1 as a function of the energy of homopolar and heteropolar terms, and we will see appearing a beta, which is correspond to this first derivative of alpha with respect to the change of chemical bond length. And then the final expression from these calculations is a function is inversely proportional to the gap and will strongly related to the length of a chemical bond. And it's also a relatively complex function of the ionicity. So this is not a linear relation, and that we will see that this term will have a maximum and corresponding to relatively low ionicity. So the one-dimensional, this is a one-dimensional beta model. So this beta is considered as a beta along the chemical bond itself, and we neglect all other terms perpendicular to the chemical bond. So now we can, from this expression, explore the various structural parameters which act on beta. You can this in relation with that, it can be inferred that the beta depends on the difference between the atomic number of the atoms. It will strongly depend on the distance of the chemical bond and depend also on ionicity. So in the next figure, we will see that beta will decrease when increasing the difference between atomic numbers. It means that for nonlinear optics, 3-5 semiconductors should be more active than 2-6 semiconductors and, of course, oxides. Beta will increase when increasing the distance, because in increasing the distance, electrons of the chemical bond are less tightly related, attached to a nuclei and become more polarizable. So this gives the advantage of heavy atoms, which ensure long chemical bonds. And the interesting result is that the maximum beta is found for a relatively small value of ionicity. And this is really this expression of the ionicity polarizability trade-off. And so we can see that beta will be zero for homonuclear diatomic molecules, such as a hydrogen molecule, but will be also zero for strongly ionic species, such as sodium chloride, lithium fluoride, and so on. And the conclusion also is that in most cases, the highest nonlinearities in semiconductors will be found in the infrared range. So that will be the main drawback. So that's here. It's only some plot of it's a log-log plot of susceptibility, second-order susceptibility, for different series. So you have the 3-5 series. So there are old results. So there is a lot of experimental results, but you can see that in general, all 3-5 compounds with delta Z is only 2 are much more efficient than 4-6, where delta Z is 4. Interesting point is also this the same for 3-5 and 2-6. And here, people found that there is a maximum, an experimental maximum, for when plotting this chi2 as a function of ionicity. And influence also of delta Z. Sorry, I think the first one is the role of interatomic distance. Sorry, that's the role of interatomic distance that is growing very fast. And you can see, of course, the difference between the 3-5 and 2-6. So here, it's this is really a plot as a function of delta Z here. And you can see the strong, not delta Z, but in fact, it's a plot as a function of the atomic number of the second atoms. That is only for the first atom is gallium, and the second is you change the nature of the atom. And then you can start here from gallium and changing the counter atom by going down in the Mendeleev table. And then we started again starting from indium, and the same exercise here. And you can see the strong increase when increasing, in fact, the atomic number of the atoms. Okay, that this relatively ancient work, and of course there are other ways to calculate nonlinearities in semiconductors. It's only here to illustrate the importance of this trade-off between ionicity and polarizability. In the case of oxides, we will expect much weaker nonlinearities because the interatomic distances are smaller. the ionicity values are higher because oxygen is a very strong electronegative system, and higher delta Z in general. So nonlinearities will be relatively weak, but the interest, as you know, because the laser users know it, transparent in the visible UV and near-infrared, resistant to optical damage, and also some ferroelectric properties which makes possible a fine control of macroscopic orientation, such as in PPLN structure, for example. So at the conclusion of this exploration of inorganics, so you can see here on this table, this is in fact the so-called factor of merit, which really corresponds more or less to the efficiency of second harmonic generation, the rate of production of second harmonic signal as a function of the transparency. This is infrared visible UV. So you can see some examples of semiconductors, and you can see how oxides are much less efficient but very transparent in the visible range. So this table was established at the beginning of nonlinear optics. First nonlinear optical material, which was identified here, silicon oxide, and all the other compounds. But very quickly, people noticed that it's possible to add to this list some organic compounds. Sorry, the color difference is not so important, but these are the most efficient organic crystals, which have been reported after the development of these inorganic systems. And for this reason, people were really interested to develop an engineering, molecular engineering, not only at the level of the atomic bonds in semiconductors or oxide, but also at the level of more sophisticated organic molecules. So, and this will be this part devoted to molecular engineering using organic system, and described in terms of molecular diode. So, in fact, this model could also apply to the previous one, because when you have diatomic bond with a strong dissymmetry, the effect will be the same. But for the molecular diode in organic system, it's much more spectacular. So what is the point? So the dipolar scheme is here. So we consider a molecule. This is the benzene ring. A benzene ring is made of alternate double and single bonds named pi electrons. They are strongly polarizable because they are far from atoms. And they can be deformed, strongly modified by the presence of electron donor groups and electron acceptor groups on each side. And you can easily imagine that when you have an oscillating external electric field, if during the first period the electric field is applied from right to left, electrons are supposed to migrate from left to right. But this system being electron attractive, this system will resist the effect of the electric field. On the contrary, if the electric field is applied from left to right, the electrons will be attracted by the field from right to left, and this is the case of donor, and the movement of electrons will be amplified. So having a more practical representation of this, that we have placed this molecule in the vertical drawing in order to be parallel to the electric field. And this is a donor group, and this is an acceptor group. This is a highly conjugated polarizable electron set. And you have an incident electric field. And the induced polarization is dissymmetric due to the fact that the molecule acts as a molecular diode. So for one half period, the electron transfer will be amplified by the molecule because of this donor-acceptor trend, and on the other half period, the molecule will oppose the electron transfer imposed by the electric field. So this dissymmetric signal, periodic signal, can be decomposed in Fourier terms, and you have a linear response here, which corresponds to a linear response, and you have a second harmonic term corresponding to the quadratic nonlinear response, and there is also a constant term. You can see here that's due to the symmetry of the patterns, and you will have a constant term which corresponds to a phenomenon which is named optical rectification. So, and this optical rectification will give an example in the next talk this afternoon. Okay, so how now to optimize this hyperpolarizability on conjugated molecule? So, sorry for so much chemistry, but this may be useful. So, then we need mainly conjugated pi electrons. And there can be aromatics. So aromatics is putting some pi electrons in a cyclic structure, but usually these cyclic structures are hexagons with hexagon of carbons, so or sometimes few heteroatoms. And all then you have six electrons fully delocalized, hence this representation of these electrons here. Polyens are more linear. We shall see an example later on. Azo groups here with nitrogen-nitrogen double bonds will have an important role to play for photo-induced process for orientation of molecules and any combination of them. So thiophane, for example, is also an aromatic system. So for this dissymmetry, it must be created by electron donor groups. And there is a relatively poor choice of electron donor. They are made of heteroatoms. Heteroatoms are atoms which are not carbon nor hydrogen. Usually, these heteroatoms are relatively electronegative, but they have a non-bonding electron pair here. It's not represented on sulfur and nitrogen, also on oxygen if it exists. With a single bond, they are related to the conjugated system by a single bond here and here. And in fact, it can be shown that this non-bonding pair can be transferred to the conjugated system, and this corresponds to the gift of one electron to the system. I'll show you later on an example of it with the arrows showing the transfer of electrons. Electron acceptors are made of heteroatoms, the same, but related to the conjugated moieties via multiple bonds. For example, here in pyridine. Pyridine has also a non-bonding electron, but it is fully included in the conjugated system, and it's related to the rest of the molecule via multiple bonds. This is the case for cyanogroup. CN is a triple bond, and so on. And in that case, there is a lot of possibilities for acceptors, including metal complexes, for example. So how to describe the beta value in relatively simple terms, not only via the molecular diode, which is a relatively naive representation, but very early people tried to make simple models to account for this appearance of beta. And in fact, they started with a centrosymmetric conjugated core, for example, benzene. And they assume that the hyperpolarizability is created by an internal field which is induced by the existence of electroactive substituents. And they consider that when having only one substituent, donor or acceptor, here and here, then we have relatively moderate beta value. But when combining donor and acceptor, then the electron, the pair, which is given to the system is completely transferred to the acceptor, corresponding really to a transfer electron pair. And in that case, we cannot consider this molecule as a pure superimposition of one monosubstituted acceptor derivative and one monosubstituted donor derivative. The beta is not the sum of this term and this term. this there is an extra term which is called the charge transfer term, which really illustrates the very strong interaction between donor and acceptor. And that is the presentation. And when going to this internal field model, in fact, we can also write this molecule as a sum of benzene ring with a field applied along this direction, EA, plus the same benzene ring, but the field applied to the opposite direction, and a term with a field corresponding to the strong interaction between A and B. And this beta is the sum of the three contributions. And it can be shown that this term is dominant over the other ones. So the internal field model, some more details. You have corresponds that this molecule is the bare skeleton, bare dense skeleton. And without, before applying this internal field, the energy is only the energy of polarizabilities of linear and third order polarizabilities, because the system is centrosymmetric. There is no reason to have a quadratic term. And when applying the internal field corresponding to donor-acceptor groups, then this field internal is added to the external field, which can be the electromagnetic field here. And this results in the expression, we can develop the expression of the energy. And the energy, the term, and these terms, which is depending on the energy itself, corresponds to the contribution of to the quadratic and nonlinear response. So, in fact, the induced dipole, which be expressed as this term, and the dipole corresponding to the quadratic term is found here. So, the induced polarizability can be inferred from this expression. And as indicated in the previous slide, this can be considered as the product of gamma mu divided by the polarizability. So then, in fact, the result of this model is that we have to couple a centrosymmetric electronic distribution with a vector. So it's interaction between a set of centrosymmetric set of electrons with a vector. And this is a relatively popular model. And the question will be how to derive this model when using a multi-dimensional system. And we shall see this slightly later in the talk. Okay, in that case, when considering the beta being the sum of an additive term, of a charge transfer term, if this beta is developed like that, it can be shown easily that the dominant term will be the charge transfer contribution. And if we assume purely one-dimensional character of the system, then we will reduce beta to its component along the z-axis between the axis of the dipole moment. So in that case, the expression you have seen before strongly simplifies and can be expressed. And in fact, we assume that for the charge transfer molecule, the energies of the molecule are limited to the ground state and one of the excited state corresponding to this charge transfer. So this is named the two-level model. And it's expressed in the sum of a product of the two terms. One term which is independent on the frequency of the incident fundamental laser light, and one dispersion term which strongly depends on the energy difference between the energy between ground state and first excited state and the energy of the laser at fundamental and harmonic. So this is important to have a term which is independent on the light frequency because it gives more intrinsic idea of the nonlinearity of molecules. So as previously, this is mu10 is a transition dipole moment, the probability to transition of between this ground state and this excited state. And the dipole moment of state is very important. And here you have the difference between the dipole moment of excited state and of the ground state. And this is reflects the non-central symmetry of the system, because if you don't consider this, you will have only gamma values. So, and the energy mismatch is the very important term. Usually, the most contribution comes from the harmonic, because this frequency is usually in the visible or UV range. And in fact, this term strongly enhances the beta values, but they are also related to absorption. So one of the important challenges of this research was to find a good nonlinearity transparency trade-off, which is found by optimizing this first term. So more details about this term. This is a static beta. And but it depends on the energy difference between one and zero state. And it will remind you what has been found by Phillips and van Vechten about inorganic chemical bonds, which is also inversely proportional to the energy of between the two states. And this is related to so-called transition probability, and is in spectroscopy related to so-called oscillator strengths. And of course, this value is the highest for high linear electronic polarizability along the axis. And of course, it also depends on the length of a chemical bond. So we find again some elements which come relatively close qualitatively of what was found in the model of inorganic bonds. And delta mu is also reflects the dissymmetry of electronic distribution or the bond polarity. Okay, so now let's go to a few slides about the way to determine this hyperpolarizability, because we are speaking of this object and nobody knows how to measure them. So it was not so easy, in fact. So I'll tell you the full story after that. But for dipolar molecules, it took some time before between the first discovery of interesting nonlinear organic molecules, this is 1964, and the release the real setup, which is really was ready 10 years after. So during these 10 years, people had only semi-quantitative data related to crystals. And as you will see this afternoon, a nonlinearity of crystals are strongly dependent on the orientation of molecules in the crystalline structure, and which makes a strong difference between with the value of beta themselves. So in fact, the best way to determine beta values is to orient, to obtain a nonlinear response, a second harmonic response at the macroscopic level. If you want it, we must break the central symmetry. And on another hand, we must make sure that the molecules will be relatively independent from each other during the measurement. So we have to put these molecules in a relatively inactive medium, so low dielectric constant medium. Some people use, in general, some chlorinated solvent relative of low dielectric constant. Water is not really recommended. And and the dipole, the coupling between the permanent dipole moment and an electric field, a static electric field applied along a certain axis, will induce a certain asymmetric order, which allows for a second harmonic generation. But of course, there should be we shall see in the next slide. You see here that the form of the cell is not made of two parallel windows, but these windows make a small angle. And the cell is moved along this direction of axis of the prism in order to change continuously the interaction length. And you have learned last week that when changing the interaction length, and if there is no phase matching phenomena, which is the case here, then you will have a periodic response of the second harmonic intensity, which corresponds to the so-called Maker fringes. So when after determination of the period and amplitude of these fringes, then it's possible to infer the expression of second-order polarizability. And because of the presence of a permanent electric field, this permanent electric field will also play a role with in interaction with the optical field. So we will have two optical fields and one electrical field. Three fields interacting together will result in a term resulting of a third-order nonlinearity. So, and sometimes this term can be important. The second term will be related to the orientation. So it results on the coupling between the permanent dipole moment and the electric field. And it's in that case, this is the part which induces the quadratic nonlinear response in terms of centrosymmetry breaking. And this is related to the dipolar part of the beta tensor. The G equal 1 here is the signature of the fact that it is a dipolar term and not higher corresponding to the one-dimensional dipolar symmetry of the molecule. And of course, the calculation to be strict must be carried out in more details. You must, in fact, have a scalar product of the dipole moment and the electric field, which is multiplied by the beta tensor. And we can show that there is, we can commute this product and resulting in, resulting in this scalar product between dipole and dipolar part of the beta tensors. Of course, because of thermal agitations, then it's ponderated by these terms, because here it's in fact a space average, an orientational average of the induced dipole moment of the molecule. So we have a sum of third order and second order. In general, if the molecules are strongly non-centrosymmetric, in general, these terms can be neglected. It has been shown experimentally. So, and in fact, what we measure is more a scalar product of permanent dipole moment and the beta. It's possible to determine permanent dipole moment either by calculation, which is the easiest way, or by experimental procedure, which are relatively tedious because it's related to measurement of refractive index and the electric constant at different concentrations. And we must have the adapt equipment, but it works also. But anyway, what is interesting for people is mainly this scalar product because the dipole moment and beta, because from this factor is directly responsible for the electro-optic response of oriented polymers, we shall see this afternoon. So this is really the relevant parameter. And in electrostatic units, mu is an 10 to minus 18 electrostatic units, CGS, and beta 10 to minus 30. So result will be given in a product in 10 to minus 48. Okay, this is the design of the cell. Now we have a more modern one, but the principle is the same. So there is a cell with electric field is applied along this direction. This is a fundamental beam, the harmonic beam. It's not visible. I made the drawing, but of course it's not visible because the system is very diluted. Molecules are put in solution with concentration between 10 to minus 2 or 10 to minus 3 mol per liter. So this concentration is very unusual to see second harmonic. And and also the orientation rate, orientation yield is very poor, a few percent, so that's a small signal. You must have a sensitive detector such as photomultiplier. And this, when moving the cell along the direction of the prism here, then we have these fringes. And from these fringes, we induce the mu beta. This is the total set than starting with neodymium laser. But usually, this wavelength corresponds to second harmonic of 532, which is fully in the in the green, and a lot of molecules maybe can be red or violet, and will strongly absorb this wavelength. So it's important to shift this wavelength more to the infrared in order to find second harmonic in the transparency range of most of materials. And this has been achieved by Raman stimulation emission in high-pressure hydrogen gas cell. And due to the fact that the vibration of H2 is relatively high energy, this is 4155 centimeter minus one, and when it's combined to the fundamental to the energy of the incident light at 1.06 microns, the first Stoke energy will correspond to a plus and associated with 1.06 micrometers, will result to Stokes, first Stokes, at 1.9 micrometers. And this is a way to produce a longer wavelength. And after some various optics, then you reach the cell, and you can see here the design of the cell from the top, and you can see this length, varying length here. And then this is the detail. And after detection, then we can infer the Maker fringes. So these Maker fringes have the same intensity because the advantage of this system is to have a constant incidence angle. So we have not to take into account the variation of reflectivity when turning a substrate with respect to the incident light. Okay. So now let's come to a few examples. Now we have the concept, we have the measurement tools. Now we are ready to explore the wide field of organic molecules and systems. And we can see a few examples of that. So the reflection is the following: how to optimize beta. So we have to get a high number of pi electrons by enhancing conjugation length. And this enhancement reduces the gap between ground and excited states and increases the number of polarizable electrons. But there is a small detail which is not mentioned here, that highly conjugated molecules are not strongly stable, and we can see here. And when we try to make molecules with maybe 40 double bonds, their lifetime is relatively poor, especially when they are non-centrosymmetric. So the point is this conjugation limited by the chain length. So early studies, very old studies, first assume a quasi-metallic behavior. This was nonsense. And in fact, this long chain behave like semiconductors, and they have a certain for maximum conjugation length for which the gap remains the same, usually in the visible for polyens. So depending on models, we expect saturation of molecular nonlinear properties, and which has been very often the object of models, and it has been shown mainly on a few tens of carbon atoms, and mainly shown with cubic hyperpolarizabilities. But the point will be the same as for the atomic system. Can we optimize the chain dissymmetry like in covalent bonds in inorganics? So let's only to show you how it has been possible to evidence the saturation of the nonlinear response. It was not possible to find it for dissymmetric molecules because the stability was too poor to reach this level, but for centrosymmetric systems, the highly conjugated molecules which were synthesized in MIT, that's This gamma value, which have been measured by simple third harmonic generation, is very simple. They found some saturation around 80 number of atoms or 40 double bonds. So I don't enter in the detail about the reason why they have been able to fabricate very long molecules with relatively correct stability. It means that these molecules could be sent to the United States and could be measured during one day in the lab, and they could be kept for a few weeks in solution, which is not so bad for the system. So in fact, it's stabilized mainly by the fact that you make some rigid, more rigid system, and introducing also stabilizing benzene rings. So how to optimize this conjugated chain also for quadratic nonlinear optics? So we make the chain more rigid, introducing hydrocarbon cycles. And this is important because pi electrons can really overlap and can be really transferred and exchanged if all these bonds are coplanar. So in the chemistry textbook, it assumes that, yes, it's 120 degrees and pi electrons makes all these bonds coplanar to each other. But in practice, you may have some perturbations of this dogma. And sometimes there are some twisting, slight twisting angles between double and single bonds, then reducing the conjugation, and then provoking a decrease of polarizability. But that is the point to optimize the polarizability, but how to optimize the dissymmetry by modifying bond alternation, and to find the best value of the difference between the length of the double bond and the length of the single bond. People who know chemistry will tell me that is nonsense because, in fact, it's not localized bonds because the electrons are delocalized. But even if it is the case, there is still, in most cases, there is a significant difference between these two values. And then people try to explore the nonlinear response, quadratic nonlinear response of molecules for different values of bond length alternation. Yeah. So this was the result of the studies performed by an American team at the beginning of the 90s. And they make some semi-empirical calculations. That's a relatively simple system with relatively good agreement with experimental data because this semi-empirical take into account some experimental data to perform the calculation. But anyway, yeah, you can see here the function of this alternation, there are maxima, zero, and minima. Of course, here, bond length alternation has a sign. In the previous description of diatomic systems, we consider ionicity and always positive. But here, with organic conjugated molecules, we can define some also negative bond length alternation. I'll show you in the next slide. But what happens, we see that beta is relatively small, either for highly alternated structure for high bond length alternation values, which is here, for example. And it cancels, of course, for a symmetric, centrosymmetric system, non-alternated structure. And it peaks at a relatively low bond length alternation value of 0.05 angstroms. So we see that the same trend as for diatomic bonds. It's not necessary to have a strong eccentric character of the bond to optimize the nonlinearity. So more details here, how to reach this optimal value. So that's classical beta, the beta zero corresponding to the dispersion free term. So we consider that the two-state model are made of superimposition of a neutral state and Schwitterionic state. And it can be shown that from donor to acceptor, it's possible to transfer a non-bonding electron to this acceptor. And this non-bonding electron comes to this bond. This one comes there. And this is so-called Schwitterionic state because there is two ions here. If the neutral form prevails, we consider that beta is negative and can range, depending on the nature of donor and acceptor, between minus 0.11 to 0. If the sphiterionic is dominant in the ground state, the sign is positive and varies from the opposite direction, 0 to 0.11. And when both forms contribute equally, you can see here that there will be the same contribution of the double bond here and here. So if you have equal weight of these two forms, then there is no bond length alteration, so no depart from central symmetry, and beta is zero. So you find exactly the same trends as for the atomic system. And so to explain how charge transfer works, I wanted to make an animation, but it's really too complicated, but only to see you here. So you have this this donor group, which is made of a nitrogen atom with two hydrocarbon groups, butyl one. And this non-bonding pair is transferred to this carbon-nitrogen chain, resulting in this bond. But as carbon cannot accommodate more than four bonds, the other doublets, the other pairs, must move. And it's kind of domino that this is here, so this moves there, and so on, hopping. And then, at the last, the acceptor properties of the system are due to the fact that this carbon-oxygen is a double bond and can be transformed in a single bond like that. So at the last step, that you form this double bond and this three non-bonding electron pair on this oxygen, which can really accommodate them because they are strongly electronegative. The same for sulfur, and there is also some other internal arrangement with the electron pairs of nitrogen. So this is an explanation how to have a charge transfer between donor and acceptor. Okay. This is a very amusing game with organic chemistry to imagine, to see the conjugation. So, and you can see here another point. Here we start with the part close to the donor is aromatic. Aromatic, it means that you have three double bonds delocalized in a hexagonal cycle. That's it's not a definition, but it's one consequence of the definition of aromaticity. And it can be shown that aromaticity brings a strong stabilization of the molecule as compared to linearly a conjugated electron pi electron system. That's much more stable. It's a reason why benzene is a really problematic compound for environment, because it doesn't degrade. It's very difficult to find degradation in benzene, including in our body, and benzene is highly cancerogenic. So this is a stabilization. But when we perform this transfer, this cycle is not made anymore of three delocalized double bonds, but this cycle becomes aromatic. So aromaticity is transferred from there to there, and we can infer that the energy levels of both forms are relatively close to each other. Not identical, because if they were identical, we should not have any bond alternation. The system would be considered as centrosymmetric. But here, that stabilization is made on the highest so-called sphaterionic level. This, of course, reduces the gap between ground and excited state. And in that case, the bond length alternation will come closer to its optimal value. And as a result, here, example for two molecules. This is the molecules we have investigated here. That's n, small n, n equal 5. And this is another derivative. The bond length alternation is 0.08 angstrom, which is relatively close to the optimal value of 0.05. And mu beta are values reaching 10,000, which are quite big values as compared to standard molecules. So this example of molecular design has been very successful and resulted in a very good properties. So coming again to the first slide, the molecule of the first slide, which is a commercial dye, dispersed red one, with a donor group we ionize nitrogen, and this contains a double the electron pair acceptor group. This mu beta is found to be relatively moderate, 300, 10 to minus 48. And we have another molecule here, which is not the same as I shown before, but a similar principle, donor acceptor group. Then the mu beta is 50 times higher, you see. And this is commercial, but this is non-commercial. And they have been able to make with this molecule some very good electro-optic modulator with low operation voltage. And the problem being, of course, a problem of stabilization in terms of chemical and thermal stabilization. But we will address this issue in the next talk this afternoon. Okay, so you can see that's the interest of this optimization. So we have really explored and probably optimized the dipolar nonlinear response. But there are some limitations of this description. So the two-level model is very convenient and so on. But you know that beta is a third-rank tensor, which can be corresponds to terms in the three dimension of space with 27 independent Cartesian components. Of course, it will be less. But it could be said that it's a pity to limit ourselves to one dimension when the world is three-dimensional. So, and this expression corresponding to this purely dipolar term is very limited to one single term of the beta tensor. So, another point is that with a relatively low symmetry of dipoles, the transparency is limited because when you increase the symmetry, some levels existing in this part are not allowed for one photon transition, and this increases the transparency towards higher levels of the system. It's not systematic, but it may happen. And the other problem we will address this afternoon is that with dipolar and one-dimensional rod-like systems, they tend to align in a centrosymmetric manner with head-to-tail orientations and leading to zero chi-2. And at the beginning of development of multidimensional beta tensors, people were hoping to have better chance to get non-centrosymmetric crystals with this multidimensional system, so it didn't prove so. This afternoon, you will hear that finding optimized crystals is more gambling than other things. But this has other interests, as we shall see later on, especially the fact that we will extend the dimensionality and to make materials which can process light in three dimensional with a relatively isotropic response. The problem with dipoles is induce strongly anisotropic material, usually. Okay, that's a famous octupolar scheme. So that's we have to question some accepted dogmas, such as is centrosymmetry equivalent to polarity? Now it's widely accepted that's not the case, but even 15 years ago, there were some people and also famous scientists which were not convinced that it's possible to find non-polar molecules with quadratic nonlinear properties. So the other point is it second harmonic? This demands centrosymmetry. Coherent second harmonic, yes, but it's possible to have second harmonic non-coherent with non-polar molecules. And the last point, which will be addressed this afternoon, can laser field provide polar order and not only axial order? So the centrosymmetry. Non-centrosymmetry doesn't imply polarity. Triangle is a very simple example. So tetrahedron, this kind of system. And so any system having some three-fold symmetry can be considered as non-polar and non-centrosymmetry. It's possible to have second harmonic generation from centrosymmetric system due to simple light scattering phenomena. Each non-centrosymmetric molecule will emit two second harmonic photons, two omega, Of course, these photons will not add in a coherent manner with the photon emitted by other molecules, but this scattering signal is non-zero. And in fact, this scattering experiment was the first setup to determine beta values. But it was at that time extremely complicated setup, and the story is more complicated. So laser fields can also provide some axial and polar order that we shall see this afternoon by interference between the three photon system, two omega, and two photon and omega, see this afternoon. So coming back to molecules, beta in the transparency range of the material, beta value can be described not only in terms of Cartesian components, beta YGK with 27 terms, but can be also developed in terms of dipolar tensorial description with tensor addition of a dipolar distribution corresponding to this dipolar system and the so-called octupolar distribution. For example, in the case of planar system, extension of these molecules can be obtained by adding two acceptor groups and two donor groups there. So you may question the fact that this is octupolar, because here you can see only six substituents. That will be explained in the next slide. And in fact, there is a relatively nice representation of what kind of architecture can be done with molecules, starting from a template which is made of a cube. And you shall see that the cube is represented in such a way that its main diagonal, threefold diagonal, is perpendicular to the plane of the figure. So you have the impression to see either a three-dimensional cube or a two-dimensional hexagon. And this is in purpose. So now we can put some positive or negative charges on this cube. And the dipolar scheme would correspond to placing a plus and minus charge at the opposite edges of the cube along the threefold main axis. And this results in our dipolar systems with some example of nonlinear molecule. So, but now to find a two-dimensional system. This corresponds to this projection of the cube on the plane perpendicular to its threefold axis, and it corresponds either to an hexagon, like here, or it can be also made by a central atom with a charge opposite and three time opposites to the charge of this peripheral atoms. So this is the extension of para-nitroaniline here, and here the central atom can be found with some carbocations substituted by strongly electron-donating groups here. And it can also be found with some inorganic molecules. So this afternoon, we will describe the properties of this barium beta borate, which is a threefold symmetry anion. Coming to three-dimensional systems, corresponds to putting alternate charges, plus and minus, on the each corner of the cube, and then you find octupole, eight charges, four positive, four negative. And this can be derived into this kind of cube, or also tetrahedra, which are also reduction of the cube with a central atom and four peripheral one, exactly like for this. So a few examples can be shown here. That's in terms of molecular structure, this can be covalent or also metal complexes. And here, we shall see this later, some kind of twisted system or superimposition of two benzene rings. So we will speak of it later on, this so-called paracyclophane. But also for tetrahedra are also extremely interesting, not very polarizable interesting. And this molecule, carbon tetrachloride, a very small and common molecule in chemistry labs, has been the first molecule to have been measured for its beta value in 65. That's the first beta measurements has been done on this one and not on dipolar one. And I want to point out for inorganic systems the importance of phosphate ions in nonlinear in designing nonlinear inorganic materials, KDP, KTP, and so on. So I think that my time is running fast. So only but at the very beginning, its octupoles were not a recent invention. The concept of octupoles for nonlinear optics has been developed relatively late in the 90s by discovery of the strong nonlinear response of this molecule. And so it questioned our dogma. But in fact, octupoles, our eyes were not really open because they are present at the very beginning of nonlinear optics. You know that the first nonlinear material which has been evidenced is quartz. That's 61, just 1 year after laser. And this is made of tetrahedra of silicon oxide. It's purely octupolar. Then very quickly, people developed the KDP. So it's not perfectly octupolar, but the bases are phosphate, which are tetrahedral. More recently, BBO, but was also developed in this part. And even for organics, there is very early studies of organic molecules. This strange molecule is made of three nitrogen atoms related by CH2 system. They are not extremely efficient, but it was the first organic material which was evidenced for nonlinear optics in 64. And the same for beta measurements of carbon tetrachloride. But people really came conscious of the importance of this concept only when they noticed the high nonlinear response of this object. It was non-polar, but it's always worse to try something which you can expect it will not work, because especially with materials, because materials are... it may open a way to new avenues in science. That is an example here. So... That's how to make measurements of octupolar, non-polar molecules. Of course, you cannot use electric field poling because there is no permanent dipole moment. So it's using the so-called harmonic light scattering. Another name is hyper-Rayleigh scattering. It's the same reality. It's made from Rayleigh scattering, the second harmonic term of Rayleigh scattering, or each independent molecule. So you can work in an isotropic medium, non-centrosymmetric, but each emitter must be non-centrosymmetric, in principle. And incoherent, it's an incoherent nonlinear optical process, so the signal is very poor, and it requires some relatively sensitive detectors. So we have, as always in nonlinear optics, we have to work with a reference molecule, ethyl violet. If you are interested, I can write the formula on the blackboard. But I don't want to scare you. So then, what is the physical response? In fact, the physical response is a special average of the tensorial product of the harmonic of the second order induced dipole moments. And it can be shown that it is, in fact, the space average of the tensorial product of beta multiplied by beta. Each beta tensor is a three-rank tensor, but if you make the tensorial product of these two three-rank tensors, you will have a six-rank tensor. Six-rank tensor is even-rank tensor and is non-zero even in centrosymmetric media. So the second harmonic response will be expressed as a sum of contribution of the solvent. And it's important to notice that the second harmonic is proportional to the concentration in harmonic light scattering, whereas for EFISH, the electric field-induced second harmonic we have seen before, this signal is proportional to the square N2 of the concentration. This is one of the reasons of the poor response of this system. So the setup is here. His example is shown also for 1.9. It's relatively difficult to work at 1.9 because the signal is much smaller. It's scattering, so it's... when you increase lambda, the scattering will decrease. And of course, the detectors in the near infrared are less sensitive, but we can manage. So in fact, the main set system is that here, this is the sample cell. It's I'll see some picture later on. And you record the second harmonic from this solution with respect to a reference, which is also second harmonic signal from an efficient frequency doubler. And what is it must be pointed out that you have a set of polarizer to control the polarization here. That's you vary continuously the incident intensity of the fundamental by rotating a half-wave plate between cross polarizers, but you can also control the polarization of the incoming beam. And by playing on the polarization of the incoming beam, it's possible not only to infer the global beta 2 tensor, which is very different from the tensor you measure from EFISH, but you can also separate the norms, the scalar norms, of the dipolar and octupolar tensor part. And it is important to find the balance between dipole and octupoles in any molecule. So this is the harmonic light scattering. This is, in fact, this contrast is not good, but the fundamental beam comes from there. Of course, it's infrared. That's only to help you to see what happens. It's coming from here, and this is the harmonic. The harmonic is coming from here, fundamental. The harmonic is collected by the big lens, but these are not visible, of course. And this is a cell filled with an organic dye. So the second harmonic response is the plot as a function of the fundamental one. And if you plot here the fundamental, then you have some kind of parabolic response. But usually, people plot the second harmonic as a function of the second harmonic of a reference in order to get straight lines. So this is an example of a complete tensorial analysis of a two-dimensional system. And these norms have been determined by using different polarization in this experiment and resulting in two different dipolar and octupolar terms. And that is very useful. So that's only to summarize the difference between the two different tools. Electric field-induced second harmonic. This is perturbation one-dimensional. It's coherent light. The second harmonic response intensity is proportional to N2, and is coherent and is strongly anisotropic. The response, when you change the polarization of the output harmonic light, there is a strong ratio of 1/9, but it doesn't bring a lot of information because we measure only one single component of the beta tensor. On the contrary, with harmonic light scattering, we use a non-coherent emission in an isotropic medium, so the intensity is only proportional to concentration, and we measure the square tensorial square of beta. So that's a definition, it's only a convention. And the anisotropy of the system can change and depends on the symmetry of the molecule. And this is called the depolarization ratio, which is related to molecular anisotropy. And from this, you can infer at least two different components of the beta tensor, especially if we use some multipolar components. Okay, so few examples now. Two-dimensional strategy, that can be a central system, a molecule, a central atom. And only to show you that in the octupolar distributions, the dispersion of beta involves three levels, ground state and two excited states. But in the case of perfect symmetry, threefold symmetry, for example, these two excited states are degenerate. And we have to consider in the expression of beta the transition moment between the two excited states. But the dispersion factor remains the same, fortunately. So if we want to make a correction from dispersion, the expression is similar to that of a two-level model because of the degeneracy of the excited states. So the description of a multipolar scheme can extend the concept of internal field, which was developed for dipolar molecules. But of course, field is a vector. So we cannot really apply a field, but a potential. And for in fact, this P should be considered as a multipolar potential applied to an initially centrosymmetric Bunsen ring, for example, and perturbated by a multipolar distribution of charges. And here it is. You have start with the centrosymmetric Bunsen ring and apply a potential, sorry, which is which corresponds to the fact that you put your molecule in a cell with three positively charged plates and three negatively charged plates. And we couple this distribution with the tensor potential. And I don't enter in the details, but for results, the interesting results that people show that when increasing the potential, the internal potential, the dipole part of the response, because you can apply also a dipolar potential, it's not forbidden. In that case, there is a saturation of dipole. The dipole very quickly becomes smaller than the octupolar part, which doesn't seem to display a saturation. So it means that we can have a much higher or a much more non-centrosymmetric octupolar distribution of external field, internal field, to get a much higher beta values. That's with the advantage of this multidimensional system. This holds for a two-dimensional molecule. So, and beta can be also represented as a function of the octupolar moment, as and it looks linear with the octupolar moment, which is not really the case, as you have seen, for dipole, because of the problem of a trade-off between centrosymmetry and polarizability in the case of a one-dimensional system. And the linear regime is coming very, the linear regime, which really limits the non-linearity, is really finished, is really over for a much smaller potential. Okay, so I finish with a few examples of octupolar structures. So it's only to show that, for example, metal complexes, they are kind of propellers, and these propellers are made of central atoms substituted by three organic molecules are named ligands, and these bonds are due to the to the sharing of the non-bonding electron pair with d orbitals of the metals. And after exploration of various kinds of substituents and metals, large beta values can be evidenced. So I hope I finish with this three-dimensional strategy with and the problem. How can we obtain high nonlinearities with three-dimensional systems? Because if you know, a three-dimensional system implies that chemical bonds will be sp3 hybridization. There is no possibility to have pi electrons in three-dimensional system, except in some exception, in some cases, but for which the overlap is not good. So planar structures imply polarizable electrons, and hexagon tetrahedral structures are not polarizable. So there is really a problem, and how to find solution to overcome this question. So we can use twisted pi electron structure, but twisting will reduce the overlap of orbitals and will reduce the polarizability. And we will see here the interest of through space electronic interaction between stacked pi electrons. So the first solution was to twist the bond between, for example, two Bunsen rings. This is the case, but you can see that beta is relatively modest. That's normal because, in fact, there is very poor conjugation between this part and this part because of the twisting. Second idea was to use metal complexes. And this is more efficient because it can be shown that there can be some small delocalization between through the metallic atom itself. But this delocalization is still modest and also difficult to obtain to have this tetrahedral symmetry because such kind of atoms tend to make planar structure. And this beta is better, but not very, very brilliant. So, and to remain in the domain of organic chemistry, there was some ideas to set up really a real cubic structure and to perform charge transfer between two highly conjugated rings, benzene rings, if it's possible to put these two cycles close to each other, where it can be found theoretically and experimentally that there is a partial delocalization of electron orbitals and overlap between this top and upper and lower levels. And if we imprint to the whole system a non-centrosymmetric octupolar symmetry here, we could expect relatively good nonlinear response. That's so-called the through-space charge transfer, which has been investigated for a long time. And the first example is, to make this octupolar molecule with two subunits. The first subunit, upper one, is centrosymmetric. The second subunit on the bottom is also centrosymmetric. But the resulting molecule display a significant beta value. It means that there is interaction between the electron of this upper and lower benzene rings, and this is the signature of the so-called through-space charge transfer. So it's not huge, but at the end, I'll show you much better result for other systems. So this through-space interaction allows for multipolar three-dimensional nonlinearities. And it shows also that, of course, an additive model between the two rings is not valid. But in fact, it's possible to find a way to make the addition of dipolar and octupolar parts of these molecules, only to compare with experimental data. It's important. And in that case, it can be shown that taking the two upper and lower benzene rings, starting from initially eclipsed conformation, each molecule, each part has a dipolar and octupolar component, individual molecule, beta j, j equal 1 to 3, and we calculate the additional additive model for beta, octupolar and dipolar parts. And we can also infer the so-called tensorial anisotropy, which is the ratio of the norms between the two beta terms. So, and it's possible to, important point is that this term is addition is performed by cosinus theta. So for g equal 1 is cosinus theta, and for g equal 3 is cosinus 3 theta. And this is reflected here. This is the additive result of addition for dipolar terms. We can see here that if molecules are put head to tail, there is a compensation of dipole moments, beta is zero, and that's maximum. But it's more complex for octupoles, and the optimum value of beta are found every pi over 3 values here, as illustrated there. So the conclusion, the final point is that when associating two centrosymmetric molecules, but one with donor groups and one other acceptor groups, the additive model would result in a zero beta, because each part is centrosymmetric, but the experimental beta is non-zero, is 50. And this is the signature of a dipolar, purely dipolar, and purely through-space charge transfer. So last example, I will stop there. This is possible to have much better values than 50 small values. And of course, we must use bigger molecules. This is a very big molecule. It's named phthalocyanins, very popular in also in photonics. And the point is to make also the stacking between these two molecules, but connected by rare earth atoms, lutetium. They are very efficient because they are strongly attractive systems, so they will put the two cycles close to each other. The distance is less than 3 angstroms. And in this situation, there is also an overlap between electrons, which are a lot of electrons from the top and from the bottom. This is not exactly the cube, it's a twisted cube because of steric constraints. You cannot have a completely eclipsed with perfect superimposition of this, for example, an acceptor and donor group. And you can see here that each subunit is also centrosymmetric, as in previous part, but the result is non-centrosymmetric and with a very big beta value, which is the highest beta value even reported for an octupole. Okay, so I think I'll stop there, and maybe this afternoon I will skip maybe the end of this part, because it's, okay, this is the conclusion. Then we have shown that from octupoles, the generalization of the internal field model is possible, and it's found the validity of the response. And then next time I will speak about organization of materials at various scales. Thank you, and sorry for being so long.